So for those of you who don't know who I am, I'm Darlene Sinclair and I'm the manager at Community Futures. So I'm pleased to be front and center tonight. It's a little bittersweet, so I'll get into that. One of the things you learn through the business planning competition, and one thing you'll always hear from me and any type of consultant that you're going to work with, is plan, 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 because when you don't expect things to happen, they will. So we've had some great humorous things that have happened during our training. I remember one of our training sessions, one of the accountants, his wife went into labor or thought she was in labor, so he was watching his phone and had to panic and he had to leave, and then somebody else had to step in. And so Jason and I talked about that, and I said, your wife is pregnant, I think it was the next year, was it? And I said, that same year. So I said, we will not go through that. We will be prepared. And he goes, it's not going to happen. Well, yes, his wife went into labor and I had to step in. bittersweet. So Jason has been doing a great job doing our Chinook Entrepreneur Challenge, and an opportunity has arisen, and he will be leaving Community Futures and leaving the Chinook Challenge. So you've got me again. So the one thing about planning is by, I guess, the grace of whatever, we managed this year to hire faculty management co-op student to kind of help us and get some world, you know, experience and just give Stuart a chance to kind of learn what, you know, business is like. So my saving grace is I've got a Vanna. So Jason will be looking after the inquiries and he will be your contact at the Community Futures. Morley and I will be chipping in and helping. So on that, before I go any further, I just want to wish Jason all the best. He's been great, and he's not leaving the city or anything, but he's done a great job for us, and I know how hard he's worked to pull this together. We've made a lot of changes this year, so Jason, thank you so much. I'm going to fumble through this a little bit tonight. I said to Jason, you pretend that you're not even here. You let Stuart and I figure out what we're doing, and if we fall down, then you just laugh at us. So the agenda is going to be very similar to what has been in the last couple weeks. We're going to just go through the takeaways and then our speakers, etc., for tonight. So because I was lucky enough not to have to attend every session, I know at this point we talk about takeaways. So Stuart is going to take that part of it.
Awesome. So last week we talked a little bit about the business model canvas with Bruce Thurston, and we had an awesome entrepreneur panel with Guillermo, Ram, and Tanya Stilson. So I know that for myself, like with the business model canvas, it was just really important for me just to understand validating your customers. And what are you doing to understand how to help your customers? Are you focusing on the qualitative or the quantitative aspect? Because you just can't compete on price and on cost reduction. You have to focus on different sections. You have to know about newness and customization. And along with that, you have to focus on certain customer segments, so such as, is it a mass market? Is it a niche market? So I know that for myself, like, it's really important to constantly test what my customer, who they are, and what they need, and what the problem is. And so we just kind of want to ask you, as the CEC participants, what are some key takeaways you took from last week with our session? Just raise your hand. Yeah.
Well, just the business model canvas. And
yeah.
The value, like, it's not write it down. It's good. It's a evolving tool that keeps changing.
Yes. Yeah, exactly. I think that's really important. The business model canvas, it constantly changes, and you have to keep retesting to make sure that you've got your mix correct. Any other key takeaways from last week or anything else you enjoyed? Don't be shy.
Well, I know I've seen the presentation, I know it's a great tool, so I hope you use it. You've got lots of access to, you know, our business analysts at Community Futures, and through RINSA, you've got, you know, a lot of good people to help you out, so please take advantage of those.
I just wanted to say that Jason's amazing, but Stuart, you're a quick study.
Yeah. You've got an endorsement already. All right, so moving on. the submission deadline, and I believe as Jason would do this, all right, all together.
March 28th at 2 p.m.
All right.
That was beautiful.
That's
what,
that will be your part of your legacy, right? So I can tell you from experience, I mean, I have been at Community Futures since 2002. We've been running this competition for 14 years, and there is never a year that goes by that we don't get the panic phone calls because my computer died, I'm trying to email the file and it didn't work, or they'll come in and they'll just go, can you review it? Well, if everybody shows up at 2 o'clock or sends it in 2 minutes to, no, we can't, right? So get your plan in early and then relax. Work hard, get it done, get it out of the way, and just be prepared. So that's my advice. So tonight, the training is the ATV Booster and social media. We've got a really, really great lineup. It's I had the pleasure of being at a ATV Booster session at CASA this at lunchtime. I was very impressed. I think there were probably around 40 people that were there. I've seen the presentation before and had the pleasure of meeting Stefan before when we started talking about a partnership. So I'm excited to introduce Stefan. He's I think it's going to be something that you're really, really going to just really want to take advantage of, and it's a great opportunity in a partnership with Chinook Challenging Community Futures. So with that, I will turn it over and ask ATV to come up and do their presentation.
Cool. Thank you, Darlene.
Thanks.
Okay. So thanks, everyone, for letting me have come here today. I saw one familiar face already who was here this afternoon. Did somebody else attend during the session we had today? Got a hand there, so two for sure. That's cool. Okay, so my name is Stefan. I'm part of the team that runs ATB Booster within ATB Financial. So it is what we call a rewards-based crowdfunding platform. A lot of questions at this time, which makes absolute sense. So I'll explain all that as we go. Kind of high level, it is a platform where you as a startup entrepreneur, maybe you as a growing entrepreneur in your business, to use a crowdfunding campaign to get some exposure around your business, especially locally, validate the business model or the business idea you might have, and as well raise some funds while you're at it. So a couple things just to go through, just to really make sure you guys understand what crowdfunding is about. Overall, crowdfunding is where we talk about the crowd, kind of on the right-hand side, and then within crowdfunding, there's always the exchange of funds. So the funds going, anyways, there's funds going towards a business or an entrepreneur, you guys, and then if your crowdfunding campaign is successful, you'll have to deliver on some type of reward that goes involved with the campaign that you're doing. So just out of curiosity, there are actually four different types of crowdfunding out there. Can anybody just shout one they can think of, except the ones that were in the session today? You're excluded. Anybody has an idea, just shout it out. So those are websites, very good. I'm looking for different types of crowdfunding.
Fundraising.
That's a way, yeah, for sure. So four different types. One, there's for example, we call crowd lending. So what that works, the crowd, they will lend you money, so micro loans, so $500, maybe $5,000. And then as a return, as a reward for that one, you as the crowd or the crowd gets an interest rate plus the loan back. We actually have a platform for this too, ATB Lender. We won't go into that too much today, but there's a platform that is available as well. Secondly, there is crowd equity. So that's the crowd, they buy micro shares of a company, and then in return, the company's successful, the crowd gets part of the profits, right? That's our return. Third, there is crowd donating, and that's the only one where we really mention donations. GoFundMe.com is a website for it. So crowd donates money to a cause. In return, you get a tax receipt and a warm, fuzzy feeling, hopefully. And then lastly, there's crowd, sort of rewards-based crowdfunding. That is what ATV Booster is about, and we'll be going on a little more tonight. So you have the crowd. They pre-buy a product, service, or experience from the entrepreneur, i.e. you guys. And if your campaign is successful, you have to deliver on whatever was pre-bought or pre-sold, any one way you look at it. Sorry? So the last one I referred to was what we call rewards-based crowdfunding. I'll explain it all very well in a few minutes. One thing to keep in mind with crowdfunding, there's always a time frame with it involved. So with Booster, you have a maximum of 45 days to raise whatever goal you might set. And your goal is a monetary value. So $10,000, $20,000, $40,000. You could do $2 million if you want to. I wouldn't recommend it because you have to hit that goal in order to get your funds. So if your goal is $20,000 and a day 45, you're at $18,000, technically you don't get a cent. So I'll get to all that later. So just to give you an idea, this is Bag and Burrows. We actually have the owner currently tuning in live, Dan Smith. Hi Dan, I think this is the camera, right? Anyway, so they approached us late last year during kind of October is when the campaign launched. So they wanted to open up kind of the Hobbit style houses, right? If you've seen Lord of the Rings or the Hobbits, right? Those kind of Shire houses. They wanted to make that in Three Hills, Alberta, where they're currently based at. But not sure, A, if there was a market for this, right? They saw some stuff in the States. It worked really well there, but would it work here in Alberta? So they wanted to do a booster campaign to validate that idea. Secondly, they wanted to get a ton of exposure around it so people know, like, hey, this is coming. Start booking all right now, right? And then thirdly is to get some funds while they're at it. So what they did, they set a goal of $10,000. Right? We kind of worked with them, so you know that's a good goal to go for now. And in order to raise those funds, you have to have rewards. So this is just a few examples they had. They had much more. But one of the main ones is a reward where for, I think, $250 here, you spend a night in the Bag and Burrow, so one of their Hobbit-style houses. So bear in mind, at this time, all this was just an idea on paper. They had some drawings. There's a couple of these photos there that actually show you the drawings they made. So nothing was actually existing yet. So they're really going out. They're saying, you know what? If we raise $10,000, we will make these Hobbit-style houses. And by doing so, selling the rewards for actually staying in it. So right now, I was just talking to them earlier today. They're already pretty much fully booked until midway summer, so they're doing extremely well, actually. And a big part of that was because of basically using Booster to sell everything already. As you can see, they did really well. Off their $10,000 goal, they raised a little bit over $17,000. So a big part for them helps us with startup expenses, lawyers, accountants, development, and all that stuff. And we're partially helping out with some funding to make sure they can build these. But yeah, so for them, good success. A big part about exposure too is they got picked up by Huffington Post, by CBC News, by CTV News, and even got a cease and desist from Warner Bros., which is, you know, there's no bad thing, it's bad media, but you know, it's an interesting one. So I know they figured out really well. I know it wasn't actually Dan, it wasn't actually their fault, it was their marketing company, but anyway, so they did really well, a lot of exposure, and despite not being open yet, right, they're opening hopefully in spring or so, a lot of people already start buying into their idea. So for them, again, confirmation, cool, people love this. We're going to get into, you know, get some financing in order, start putting time and effort into making this. So this is a example of how you could use a booster campaign. So just to kind of go, if it kind of got your interest, so why should you do crowdfunding? Kind of to with the example before with Dan, and Linda, I should mention his wife as well, Dan and Linda. But so one of these houses they're trying to make, they cost close to $40,000 to build. So their goal was $10,000, right? So for them, there was enough just to kind of validate the idea they have. But obviously, it wasn't even enough to make one of these houses. So one of the things we do say with Booster, don't do it for just the funds. Because you might not even get enough to actually start your business. You might still need some additional financing. So use the financing just to get a little bit of a head start to where you want to go, or just use that to validate that idea. So we kind of put an X through the funds. Secondly, which is mostly where a big part of why you should do crowdfunding, if you're considering it, is to get a test that idea you currently have. Right, you here as an entrepreneur, you see that demand in the market, right? There's a question mark, demand for what you think is a good idea. That's the light bulb, but you want to see if it works. So you can do a crowdfund campaign to see if it's successful or not. Because if you fail your campaign, you can use the learnings from that to actually go back to the drawing board, change the business plan up, and maybe do a crowdfund campaign again. And hopefully the second time over you are successful, and then you know that that model is hopefully profitable. Right? Instead of going with the original idea, maybe bootstrapping it for 3 years, and then finding out, like, I'm broke, and the business didn't really work out. right? So, and we've had entrepreneurs before in the past that did a crowdfund campaign, they failed, changed it up, tried it again, second time successful, and now it's actually a profitable business. So, very easy way to do some testing. And then thirdly, which is for Booster, our main purpose for you guys, is to give you that exposure. Kind of a bad photo to see right now because of the lighting, but this is a Booster stage event, and we're actually, one of the reasons I'm here today is to let you guys know one of these events is coming to Lethbridge on March 21st, and you might be able to get on the stage there. But anyway, we do large stage events. We have quite a few viewers on our website, somewhere between 60,000 to 70,000 views a month. We have newsletters that we send out. We have our social media channels. So a whole bunch of stuff that we do to give all of you, if you're doing a Booster campaign, to give you exposure within the Alberta community, mostly. So basically, those three things, keep these in mind. Okay, so if you're considering doing a Booster campaign or crowdfund campaign, so kind of some tips here what you should do to be successful. One major piece is that we say, like, are you a marketeer? So we do definitely say understand social media very well, because you're drawing everyone to a digital website, right? And if you don't, and in order to get people to a digital website, you need a digital platform, i.e. social media, right? So that's a big part in order to get there. So even just to give you an example here, top left, let's actually go with this one, sorry, top right. So this is Beauty Bus. They're actually basically a spa on wheels, but instead of just showing pictures of the spa and people are getting their nails done and whatever, there's actually a whole bunch of other stuff which relates to her brand, right? There's some cool quotes in there about, you know, focused on the women. So it's way more than just a spa on wheels. It's all about the branding around it, being very much local, and why people say, cool, I like this brand. I want to be attached to this brand in a sense. I want to boost their campaigns, right? So keep that in mind, that social media is quite a strong, important part to have for a successful campaign. Another thing to really look into, obviously, is your rewards itself. So this is how you rate the funds, right? So let's say you are a coffee company. In itself, you sell coffee beans, right? But in order to make it a little bit more interesting, you want to do more than just have one reward with a bag of beans. You want to add a couple things in there. So you want to add maybe a bag, and with that bag comes a mug, and then you have a bag with a mug and maybe a grinder, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. You can keep going. So try to think about 10 to 15 different types of rewards you want to be able to offer to potential people to boost your campaign. You can start with less, right? You can always add on as you go. And then you have a reason to go back to your social media, say, people, hey, cool, I just got a new reward on there. Go have a look. Focus on the uniqueness of the opportunity. So maybe you can say with some rewards, you know, this is a limited time offer only. So let's say you're offering something, again, let's say go for coffee. You have a specific blend that's only available right now during the Booster campaign. And whatever your business is, right, you probably have a way of making something unique. So add it in there that people want to boost you, because they will be the only ones to have it. Spread around your amounts. Kind of what I said earlier, right, just start small with one bag and you can keep adding items to it. So you can start at the bottom of $30, you can go all the way up to $400 or even $1,000 if you want to. With having said that, like, we have had entrepreneurs in the past who as well put some rewards in there which were specific for business clients. Actually, the business did pick it up, and they were often at the nice higher amounts, right? So they got a lot of business from just one specific reward. The big one we recommend to you is to collaborate. So collaborate with potential existing businesses already, or even among yourselves if you want to. But let's say, you know, again, let's go with a coffee example. You put a coffee bean on here, but then you also, with that reward, you get a cake from a famous local bakery, right? And you promote them on your social media, but if they promote you on their social media, and if they're, especially if they're established, you get a lot of exposure from their part, right? So try to find if you have some connections to work with some other local well-established business that might help out quite well. And lastly, which is really cool to do, just test your business offers through it, right? Whatever you're offering as a service or experience or a product, put them in there as rewards and see if people pick them up, right? If a certain reward, nobody is purchasing that reward, maybe that specific product doesn't really make sense, but maybe another one gets sold a lot. So you get to learn, in a sense, what your customers really think about what you have to offer. So you get to really test it out. So just to give you some ideas of entrepreneurs that we haven't gone through the platform yet, just to give you some inspiration. So one, we had a Ron restaurant before in Edmonton. They, one of the rewards was you'd be the first people to dine in the restaurant. Another reward they use is that you would actually, the head chef would show you how to make ramen, so you would do it together. So that was a reward they used. Apparel always worked really well, right? Very clear, apparel-based products. We've had a few tech-based come through there, so in case you're developing an app and you're offering something through the app, use that, right? Maybe there's a form where you can have a discount for the users or whatsoever, right? You can play around with that. There's actually a company who wanted to move to Nanton. They are in Kimberley, BC. They wanted to move to Nanton. They filled their campaign, so they actually did not end up moving to Nanton, but what they do is more of experience-based, so with friends, family, co-workers, you can go in and they'll shoot kind of a Western-style silent movie. So at the bottom left, you see a guy playing dead with an arrow in his back. So very much experience-based. You can be as a campaign. Baked goods, always works, sweets, everybody likes sweets. And then this one is more of an interesting version. So typically, rewards-based crowdfunding is very much business-to-consumer, B2C. However, this company is B2B, so business-to-business. They're called Common Good. They're based in Calgary. And very high level, what they do is they offer, they actually hire people from homeless shelters to do the linens of local restaurants and hotels. So their clients, Common Good, their clients are hotels and restaurants, so B2B. But they spoke to these hotels and restaurants, explained what they were going to do, and they got gift cards and vouchers from them and used that as a reward for the consumer. So that's how they still raised the funds. Plus, it still had some rewards in there for hotels and restaurants and still got some, managed to get some new clients. So there's a way, if you're a little more creative, you can absolutely make it work. One major important thing you want to have on your booster campaign is a video. So for our website, it is a mandatory thing to have a video. Why? Is because a video is trust and credibility. Especially if you're a startup, nobody has really heard about you or your business. If you go on there with just maybe a photo of, you know, your logo and maybe one of your products, say, cool, I want $20,000, it's really tough for people to actually buy into that, right? They want to have a face with it. So that's why I say video is extremely important. A couple of things you want to look into when you're making a video is, what is your story, right? Explain that part. If you can add some goosebumps in there, that does always help in a way. Get to the point fast, so don't go all the way back 20 years ago when you had this epiphany moment about this idea, right? Make it efficient, make it quick. Explain why are you doing this crowdfund campaign, right? So I'm trying to raise $20,000 so I can purchase this equipment so I can be more efficient in my product, or I'm trying to actually expand my business into Lethbridge or going into Medicine Hat or whatsoever, right? You can play with those ideas. And then humor and musing in the video goes obviously a long way. For the video, I've had entrepreneurs range between spending $200 to $1,500 to $2,000, so you can definitely play with that. We've had many entrepreneurs where they did just write their own storyboard, went off to rent the camera, shot a little bit, helped play a little bit with iMovie Maker, and that was still sufficient enough. So don't spend too much money on your video unless you have the funds available to do it. You can do it absolutely cheap. And to the point why we make videos mandatory is that campaigns with a video raise 250% more dollars than those without a video. And as I mentioned before, right, you've got to hit your funding goal to get your funds. So then the video is obviously the difference between getting your money or not, right? Going a little bit deeper into what ATV Booster is all about. So I'll show you a quick video. Audio actually? So I'll show you a quick video here, a little bit over a minute, just kind of explains what Booster is, what we do and all that stuff, and then we'll continue after that.
You have a great business idea that you want to test or bring to market. Maybe you've got your business up and running already, but it's in need of more exposure. You're probably aware of crowdfunding and how it can help you. But have you heard of ATV Booster? It's a rewards-based crowdfunding platform from ATV Financial, exclusively designed for Alberta entrepreneurs. Booster makes it possible for Alberta-based businesses to test ideas, promote their company, and raise money in exchange for a reward. The reward could be a product, service, or unique experience from their business. Once approved, you set up a campaign page with a pitch video and pre-sell products and services from your business to the crowd. If enough people like your business concept and purchase rewards, you can hit your crowdfunding goal and have a successful campaign. Most importantly, you'll learn a ton about your business along the way. Booster is much more than just a crowdfunding platform, though. You actually get advisors who work with you from the very start of your application through to the completion of the campaign. You get access to marketing and support through ATV channels, including invaluable exposure through the Booster Stage Live pitch events. Plus, you get professional coaching to help you perfect your story and pitch. Expert support is provided every step of the way. So, how do you get started? It's really easy to apply. Just go to atvbooster.ca, click on apply, and submit your application online. It's that easy. ATV Booster, just another way that ATV listens.
Okay, I said the same thing this afternoon to the crowd, in case you're like, I've seen this video like 100 times, and maybe once I've seen it now for the second time, so like I was only going to shoot myself. The little tune gets so frustrating after a while, to be honest. It's a good video, the little tune. Anyways, so we started ATV Booster just to help you amplify your voice of our entrepreneurs here in Alberta. Right, so we have the stage events, we have all these social media stuff that we do, so we can help, you know, the small guys essentially get a little bit bigger within Alberta. One of the reasons we're also coming right now to Lethbridge is we want to help, you know, entrepreneurs in this area as well to get expanded. This is why we're very happy to partner up with well, formerly Jason, in a sense, I guess, Darlene and her team now. I'm not sure who I should really point to, but anyways, the CEC and overall, just to help you out if you're interested in just get your business a little bit further. So one of the things we do with that is we've launched the We Believe in You MasterCard. So if any of you are successfully raising $10,000 or more through a booster campaign, you get from us a $10,000 booster MasterCard with that limit, so not cash, limit. Doesn't matter what credit scores look like, you don't need financial statements, all that stuff, you get that from us regardless, if only you raise a minimum of $10,000 through your booster campaign. So you have to have approximately close to 100 different people boosting you, which is the average amount anyway, so that's there for you absolutely to use and have. If you're considering booster, each and every one of you will get assigned one of our advisors. So we have actually trained a team within ATB who know quite well about crowdfunding, have some experience in that part. So all these things I mentioned before, right? Your rewards, your video, your dollar amount you want to go for, right? Make it realistic but not too ambitious, your social media and all these little things. So they'll walk through all the steps to set you up. Bear in mind, it's still you doing all the work, and you'll hear in a second from, I brought someone out today, Heather, to talk about her experience, but it's a lot of work, it's not easy. So you're still doing it, we're just helped her a little bit to help out. We also vetted a whole bunch of different companies out there from marketing, accounting, legal, video makers, whatever, what have you, to help you out if you want. So it's available to use, it's completely up to you. They provide some form of discount as well to boost your entrepreneurs. But it's there, we vetted them, so they understand crowdfunding and all that stuff, so it's available. Another thing we have is we invested quite a bit of time and money in a resource section. So even if you have just some downtime, you can just go on the resource section. There's a whole ton of videos from former Booster alumni who were successful, and they kind of talk about their experiences and their tips and tricks and what worked and what didn't work, and especially their failures, right? So you can learn from their failures. And now what I'm going to do in a second here, I'll introduce Heather. So she's the owner and founder of Bravery Blends Coffee. She raised a little bit over $11,000 last year in April when she did her campaign. Really just a way to kind of get her brand out there to kind of, you know, should she start a coffee company or not, right? So I'll start quickly with her video so you have an idea of why she did a crowdfunding campaign, and then I'll let her share some tips and tricks.
First responders are important to everyone. My husband is a police officer, and a lot of our close friends are police officers, firemen, the military, the veterans, they're dispatchers, the corrections officers. I don't think often we take a minute to think about how much they really do for us and how much we put on the line. I knew I wanted to find a way to give back and decided that I would sell coffee for a cause, that coffee would be a great link between what they do something that gets them through the shift. Really, there's always a first responder working 24 hours a day. When you purchase a package of Brewery Blend coffee, you're getting fresh, local, roasted, organic, fair trade. We give a portion of all of the coffee proceeds back to programs that are supporting first responders and military members and veterans of Red Cross Directions.
Okay, so quick question. When watching this video, what is the main thing that takes you when watching? What does kind of make you feel?
Yeah. My friend Warren's in it.
Yeah.
Yeah.
No, I remember. I remember you from somewhere. And I remember it was September last year.
Yeah,
I remember
right.
We had the same thing, yeah. Anything else that kind of struck with you watching this video?
I carry an emotion with it. It's really touching.
Very good. Yeah, perfect. Good. Yeah.
It personally gave me goosebumps.
Yeah.
I'll be supporting it.
Awesome, very cool.
Just recognition you see like the workers there and recognizing, and we always have interactions with them, sometimes on a daily basis, or if you're in a situation, involved in a situation, sometimes they sit for first responders.
Yeah.
It just
touches them. Yeah, I touched them for sure. Well, great. Those are actually super points. So just kind of take it away. If you're sitting doing a crowdfunding campaign, like bring these things in your video, right? Because this definitely adds more purpose, like why you're supporting mobile, right? It adds way more to it. One thing that I love about it, it's the same thing this afternoon about this video, like the product placement is amazing. Every time that mug, like right there, logo in your face. You can't forget that logo. Anyways, I'll let Heather talk now. So,
hello. I thought you guys would appreciate this. I have my 7-second pitch that they talked about the other night. So, my name's Heather, I'm the founder of Bravery Blends, and I sell coffee for a cause. So that's my 7 seconds. So this is actually my third year as a participant in the challenge. I'm not giving up, I'm gonna keep trying, and so should you, because only 3 people or however actually make it to the end, so I don't know, it's just something I'm gonna keep working at. So I am really proud of that video. I don't actually like watching myself on there, but it took a lot of time to get the video that we wanted. It took months and months to film that. So really what I wanted to share is my experience with Booster. I decided to do crowdfunding for the reason that they told you not to, which is to raise funds. But to me, I didn't want to start out borrowing money from anybody, and so I thought, like, I did a lot of research, and I thought that was a pretty great idea that I could get my products out there, see if people liked the idea, because to be honest, even my own husband was against me on this. And I had said to him, I have this idea, like I wanna find a way to raise money for PTSD, and it's a cause that's really important to us, and I wanna give back. So maybe I could sell coffee, and he's like, yeah, I don't think so. Like, it'll never compete with Tim Hortons. And I was like, oh yeah. No, wait, I'm not Tim Hortons. Like, I could totally do this. So I had to win him over first. And I didn't like totally take his advice, and I just kept going, and then I talked to people about it, and like, do you think this is a good idea? And I mean, you talk to the right person, and they'll say, yeah, that sounds great. But this is a way to actually you know, prove it. So, you know, you've said to me, it's a good idea. Now, would you actually buy it? So, that's why I decided to crowdfund. So, poll a whole bunch of people, see if they'll actually buy it. And then, I didn't want to just sell coffee, I wanted to sell mugs and merchandise and that kind of stuff too. So, it was a way to kind of put all of that together and then see what people bought. I even came out with a tea line because lots of people were like, I would totally support you, but I don't drink coffee. So I'm like, that's okay, I have a plan for that. I have three types of tea, honor, courage, and valor. And so I came up with tea that kind of went with the brand. And so that they didn't have an excuse not to buy the $60 package, they could buy tea. But I'm not gonna lie, crowdfunding is a ton of work, and I did not know how much work it was before I started. I would do it again, but there is definitely things I'd do different this time. So before you launch, some good advice I had was to start sharing it with people so that it wasn't just like all of a sudden you just launched and it was out there in the world. People didn't know that, you know, they don't even know what crowdfunding is. So a couple months ahead, if I met someone and told them about my business, I would say, well, I'm actually about to launch a crowdfunding campaign, and a lot of people don't actually know what that is. So you can explain to them, I'm going to sell my product, in return you'll support me, and then if I reach this goal, I get money towards the launch, and people love the idea. So building up hype at the beginning was really important to me. Now, setting your funding goal is really difficult because it's easy to say, okay, $5,000, that seems like an attainable goal, but I wanted to push myself out of my comfort zone because I thought $5,000 was pretty doable. So I actually set it to $10,000 in 30 days, and that was really to push myself. But it turned out well. So then another thing is budget. So it is free to run an ATV booster, but you still need a little bit of money to do some of these things. So for me, the video, I didn't actually realize it was mandatory, but it was really important to me because it was like my commercial and I needed it to tell a story. And it's probably the cheapest like ad campaign you could ever, you know, do versus like a commercial or something. So I hired a young girl here who was finishing up her fourth year of media studies and paid her a few hundred dollars, and I explained to her what I wanted this video to be, and we kind of created this story. And probably the hardest part was just getting permission to film a police station and all that. So it took like 4 months to actually wrap up the filming there, but that was worth every penny. And product photos, so she helped me with some photos. So actually in the campaign, like when you click on each of the rewards, you can see a picture of what you're actually buying. So I've invested a bit of money into that. Social media, I decided, you know, about $100, which isn't a lot of money for social media ads, but I just like, I did $10 Facebook ads. So I topped it out at $10. So each click, if someone clicked on one of my ads, it was like a few cents per click. And once it reached $10, then it wouldn't get charged anymore. So that was a way for me to kind of set a budget for marketing. And then I did a website landing page. So I'm not really a technical person. Like, I don't know a lot about that kind of stuff, but I knew enough. I just found like an online website building company, did a landing page, and it had my video, my logo, and just enough to send you right back to the crowdfunding campaign. So during the time, you couldn't do anything on my website. Like now it's a live e-commerce, but at the time it just said, you know, introducing this company and check out our crowdfunding campaign. So it just kind of looped people. And so that was worth the little bit of money that it cost, because you can have like a website landing page for $10 a month for a few different companies. Picking your little packages, but I actually had a lot of fun picking these packages. So I had like one called Shift Work, and it was coffee and a Stanley thermos, and the Daily Grind was a stainless steel water bottle and a pound of coffee, and then Off Duty was actually like a full coffee scrub and body butter and that kind of stuff. So I had a lot of fun coming up with the little packages. So I made sure to have a lot of different prices. So the lowest was $10 and highest was $300 to reach a lot of different budgets. But ironically, I only sold one $10 package and I sold nine $300 packages. So yeah, I realized that people weren't, it wasn't really about the money. It was like, you know, some people bought it because they really liked the products, they liked the cause, or they believed in me. But regardless, they bought something, and there was something for everyone and something for every budget. So the ATP platform, like once you've decided to start your campaign, it kind of walks you through. So it'll say, now you're going to write this, and then you're going to add your packages and some pictures. So it's really easy to use, and I appreciated that. And then once you launch the campaign, you're just sharing and sharing as much as you can. I didn't even have an Instagram for my business before, so I created an Instagram account, Facebook account, and I just shared posts like different products. And actually, you could still go to my Instagram today and see some of my lower posts there. Add posts to different products. Sometimes I talk about the cause. So I spent a lot of time sharing that. So I chose 30 days, which was a tough thing to decide on. But first 2 weeks, I sold tons of packages, and I had a few orders every day, and the total was slowly climbing, so I was really excited. And then I got to week 3, and I didn't have any orders, and I was $3,000 or $4,000 short of $10,000. And I was really regretting my decision to have not gone with $5,000. But I thought about it, and it was the July long weekend, and people were camping on holidays and stuff. So I think it's important to remember, if you decide to launch a campaign, to look at the calendar and kind of see, like, is Christmas holidays in there? Are people going to be away for a couple weeks? There's some research online. You can Google, like, the best day to launch a campaign. So maybe it's a Monday or Tuesday, not a Friday, where people are starting to look at their email a little bit less, that kind of thing. So when I got to the third week and I wasn't getting a lot of orders, I really dug deep that week. I started to reach out to everyone personally. So I went through my email list, the old-fashioned address book, my cell phone. I messaged, like, wrote up a nice little letter and sent it to a few businesses that I thought would support me or the cause. And by the 28th day, I reached my goal of $10,000, 100% funded, on day 28. So when we reached midnight on day 30, we were at $11,025. With 122 boosters. So I surpassed my goal even beyond what I thought I would do, but it kind of showed me at the end that people wait till the last minute. If they know they have 30 days, they will take 30 days. And so you keep that in mind when you're choosing how many days to run it for. And then when your campaign's over on day 30, the work isn't done. You still have a lot of work, and I was really excited that night. I celebrated with my family, and I got home and realized I have a ton of work to do now. So I can't actually celebrate, and I won't actually celebrate until all of these rewards are in people's hands. Had to order all those products, get the coffee roasted, and then package. I think I had 45 things to mail out, and I decided, for me, so fulfillment is kind of something that you have to decide, like, how are you actually physically going to get this stuff to people? I came up with a package called I Need My Reward Ship. So if you needed your reward, you would add $15 to it, and I'd ship it anywhere in Canada. I totally picked that number off the top of my head, and thankfully it worked out. The average mail-out probably cost me about $13 across Canada. I had a few in the Yukon and Nunavut that cost me $25, but I didn't care. They were likely RCMP posted in the middle of nowhere, and I wanted them to get my copy because I want these people to come back to me. So that's actually something I used going forward with my online store, because I wanted to set a flat rate fee. So I could use that as a takeaway. So $15 flat rate fee, and coffee is heavy. That's still my rate today, and I ship across Canada, and I lose some and I gain some each time, but that was something I learned from this experience. And another thing that was great was establishing relationships with businesses. So now I had a good relationship with my coffee roaster, with the companies here in Lethbridge, some of them that did my hoodies and my hats, and I paid my bill on time. They provided a good product for me, so I knew coming out of the campaign that I had this relationship already established. Plus, I had customers now. So, you know, I knew that the coffee was really good, and if they had it once, they'd probably come back for more. So that's probably the number one thing. Some of those are still my customers today, and they just believed in me during this campaign, and I continued to deliver good coffee to them. And my business idea was validated through this campaign, so I think that's the most to get out of one of these. And since we launched in September, we've sold 460 pounds of coffee. 100 were sold during this campaign. And I never believed that we would sell that much coffee. So people, I know that they love the coffee, but I think they really believe in my cause too. So I am a socialpreneur, I say. I'm a business with a purpose. I sell something, but I have a cause, and that's really what's behind my business. Our coffee is sold at a cafe now. We have one fire hall and sold here at Lethbridge Tactical in Lethbridge. And next year, well, this year, actually probably next month, we're working on a bravery brew with Cooley Brewing. So I've taken my idea of this little coffee business and turned it into something that we can brew in different methods. So we're gonna have a bravery brew. And it's been pretty cool to see like how it started with just a little idea of coffee, but now I can see it like so much more. So yeah, that's really my experience, and I'm happy to share it with you, or if you wanna contact me later, I can let you know your ideas.
Questions for Heather? Here. Take advantage. Cool. Right there.
So the amount that we sold comes out of the 11,000. So you're left with.
Yeah, so you have to fulfill all of that. And someone asked me that today. You know, how much did you take away from that? So I figure out of 11,000, I had $3,000 left in cash that wasn't spent on products. So that was still a pretty good chunk.
Yeah, so you're glad you went to 10,000 instead of 10,000.
I am, because I think if you got to 5,000 and you'd have even that much less at the end.
I was a $60 tea, so I'm glad you did tea.
Oh, I remember that.
Perfect. I'm gonna back of here, that looks pretty cool. Is anybody else boost a hair campaign in your room, or? Curious.
That's okay, I'll take one.
That's
all I needed.
Yeah, her $10 Facebook copies.
Nice, there you go.
And it was the cost, because I don't drink coffee.
That's right, and I remember delivering to you. So, yeah, and someone said that to me, well, honestly, how many of these people were first responders that supported you? And I figure about like 70%, they must have met me somewhere, and we're with the RCMP, so we do move a lot. I've met a lot of people. But out of that, you know, 30% I've never met before, and they either knew someone who was a first responder, I don't know, I guess some people just liked the idea, but somehow they found out about me and they backed me.
Cool. Question right up front.
How did you determine that profit margin? Like, how did you gauge that at the beginning for the prices that you were?
How much to, like, set each price for? I actually kind of went with the retailers, like, so if I was selling like a certain thermos, I did research to see like how much do these other places sell this item for, and then I tend to like sell things for a little less than the average place, but I'm also just running a business from home and I'm not having to, you know, have a big storefront or anything, so I picked something reasonable that I would pay for an item. And I actually polled a few people. I said, okay, this is what I'm gonna sell. How much would you pay? Even coffee. So my coffee sells for $20 a pound. It's fresh, locally roasted here in Lethbridge at Puppers. And yeah, you could go and buy coffee at the grocery store for $6 or something, but my coffee has purpose. It's local. And I have lots of reasons why it's sold for $20, and I've sold 460 pounds of coffee, so I'm doing something right. But picking the price on anything, I think, is really hard. But I think the best advice comes from people that, you know, peers. Asking a person, like, what would you pay for this? And then kind of take an average.
I French press my coffee, like I have a grinder at home.
Yeah, and it's roasted right here in Lethbridge.
Yeah.
And you're supporting somebody local. And we've actually had so much support of our signature blend that we're coming out with a dark roast called Night Shift next month. So I'm doing lots of new things.
So who does Cuppers do all your bagging and stuff as well for the coffee, or do you do that?
Yeah.
Okay, so that's part of you. You pay them a fee, and they do that stuff for you. But you spark you to add an extra 15 for shipping, because that shipping is expensive.
Yeah, and it's all the little things like that.
So you're kind of a social enterprise where you actually are doing this for a cause.
Yeah.
So with the money you raise, what percentage do you give back to the PTSD or whatever it is?
Right, so right now, what I've committed to is $1 for every pound. Okay. It goes to Wounded Warriors Canada, which is a national charity that gives back to military first responders. They have horse therapy and dog therapy, and then lots of things for families too. And funny, somebody asked me that today at lunch, and I actually wanted to give them more, and I said I'm gonna start with $2 or 20% or something like that. And I talked to the charity, and they said, we don't want to take that from you. Actually, we'd rather see you keep more money in your pocket, get this business off the ground, and then you can give us more money. So they actually said, we don't want that much, and they chose a dollar a pound, which I respected that, because I was just going to give away more, but it was good advice, because now I can build this up, and now I'm going to have a dark roast, and I'm actually including a new charity, a local charity to Alberta for first responders, and they'll be my charity of choice for my dark roast. And I don't know what I'll do with the beer yet.
Just drink it.
Oh, they'll be a charity.
It's a good charity.
You have to have a reason to drink.
It's Wednesday.
Yeah.
Will you be around after class?
Yeah, I'm actually a participant, so I'll be here every week too, and I brought some business cards. So I would love to help with crowdfunding if someone needs me, I'm around.
So what was the most valuable part of the experience for you? Was it the money, the support, the recognition that you got?
Well, the money definitely helped, and it helped because a lot of the companies, the stuff that I wanted to order to be able to sell, you had to order a minimum like 48 or 72. And I was really anxious, and probably like most entrepreneurs, it's like, I'm literally going to take that money out of my family's grocery money and put it on a hope and a dream that this is gonna work. And I was really anxious about that. And so this was awesome way to do it, because like with my shift work package, for instance, the minimum was 78 or something. I ended up ordering like 170 some of this one cup, because it was so popular. And then I had, on everything, I made sure I ordered a little bit of extra of everything so I could sell it later. And that was able to come out of those funds too. So it helped me a huge amount for startup money, but it validated the idea that it wasn't just something like, I think this is a great idea. It was other people, and I actually copied and screenshotted all of the people's comments that they wrote to me, because that's what it continues to inspire me. And people that, you know, they believe in me, and so I think to me that's more valuable than money.
Did you see a correlation in your social media presence with this booster? Like an increase?
I kind of started them at the same time, which probably would be backwards, because I think you should start your social media way before. But yeah, I now have, well, at least on Instagram, I probably have 720 followers, and Facebook is about the same, so people followed me on both. So yeah, I went from 0 to 700.
Is
so
that
that's
Facebook
good.
On your personal page, or do you have like a Bravery Blend?
Yeah, I have a Bravery Blend Facebook page, and I have an Instagram, and I have
LinkedIn?
A website.
Are you on LinkedIn?
I am on LinkedIn.
There's a lot of law enforcement groups on LinkedIn.
I have to work on LinkedIn. Also, I have a day job and kids too, so like most of you too, I'm trying to balance like all of these things. This is something I do because I love it and I'm passionate about it. The other thing pays the bills. So, yeah.
Cool. Okay. Thank you, Heather. Okay, I'll just kind of round it off here. Perfect. So, as I said a little bit in the beginning, one of the reasons that we're here today is to really talk about the A2B Booster Stage Live pitch event that's coming on the March 21st. So, how this event looks like is that on a date, we actually just confirmed a room at the Galt Museum.
Yep.
Sorry, I was taking a drink. There's so many cool names. I actually just now, when I drove up here, this is the coolest thing I've ever saw. There's a street here called Whoop Up. I was looking at my phone and they renamed the street in Calgary to call it National Lap. I'm like, oh, that's the best they come up with in Calgary. It's like the Whoop Up Drive. I'm very curious of their story behind it, like how that name got made, but anyways, for a different time. So we're doing these events, so we just got the room and all booked. So we're hoping to have about 100 to 150 people actually in the room as an audience. And we'll have maximum of 4 to 5 entrepreneurs on the stage pitching in front of the crowd. You have to have a live crowdfund campaign at that time. So you have to be, basically like Canada before, you have to be at that time raising your funds, basically. So 4 to 5 entrepreneurs will be chosen. You have 3 minutes to pitch your business, and we'll cut the mic at the 3 minute mark. We do a whole bunch of coaching with you to make sure that 3 minute pitch is perfect, so we'll help out with that for sure. After 3 minutes, we have 4 judges, which are local entrepreneurs, some influencers, and all that stuff, ask some questions based on their experience. We kind of tell, like, no dragons, then, but nice questions. So don't be worried about the judges. And then after all this has gone through, we actually provide a pot of money. And then everybody in the crowd, they can text to vote to the favorite entrepreneur. So each entrepreneur will get a percentage of the votes, and that percentage of the votes is the percentage of the pot of money, which we will put into your crowdfund campaign. So especially if you're trying to go for a specific goal, right? Because remember, you need to hit that goal, so the funds will go straight to it, so you get a little bit quicker to that goal. So March 21st is when that is happening, and one thing that we said as well as with our partnership with the CEC, so out of those 4 to 5, 2 are for sure reserved for CEC participants. So 2 entrepreneurs here tonight or watching currently live will be on that stage for sure. So in order to potentially get there, so kind of how to take the next step, if you're interested, go to a2bboost.ca. I'll probably talk to Darlene, see if we can email maybe some stuff after. Anyways, there's a button that says apply. Basically, all you have to do is submit some of your contact information, just your phone number, business name, all that. We'll have one of our advisors reach out to you within 24 hours, and they'll walk you through Booster all together and answer all the questions you want. You explain your business, where you are right now, what the stage you're in, what the model is, what your ideas are, and they'll fire back some questions. And just to make sure, if you're a good fit or not, right? Because we want to make sure we set you up for something that's actually going to work. But anyway, you can ask all the questions too, and they'll help you get you ready on time to be potentially on this actual event at that time. Questions? Yeah?
So if you don't raise the money that you've asked for, does it just automatically just go back to everybody's accounts, or how?
Yeah, good question to ask. So how that works is that once your campaign is over and you have been successful, only then is when we actually go into the back end, and then the people who said I pledge to boost this campaign, only then is when we charge your credit cards for the first time, and only then is when you get the funds. So if you're not successful, nobody has been charged money, it's just been we saved the credit cards, but by then we just deleted them essentially. Yeah.
So if you say that you just want to raise $5,000, mm-hmm, and you go way above that, you still get the money that goes way above it?
Yeah, good question.
So what's the point of, I guess, saying you would raise $10,000, like, are people more willing to give you more money to reach the limit? Because if you go past the limit, people are less likely to give you money, maybe?
Well, it's a good question, and there's different ways how you can see it. So first of all, you want to set something based on why you're doing crowdfunding campaigns, and something that's realistic. Because despite, we have actually set a minimum of $5,000, but even to, like, the reason why I had about $10,000, I think someone here asked a question about if you did $5,000, what's really the margin that's left with it? Because
yeah,
a lot of people might think, so $5,000, what can you really do with it, right? So $10,000, a little bit of a better goal to go for. And I just lost, what was the second part of your question?
Well, like, $5,000 would be safe.
Right.
But are people less likely to give you more once you've already reached your goal,
right?
I guess, right?
Yeah, so we've actually seen that basically how typically a even to answer a question when we're global or global larger, and Heather noticed that too, is that typically we see that within the first week or two, you actually go pretty fast and you start rocking, if you do well at least. And then everybody plateaus after week, one and a half, week two, everybody does that. And then it kind of stalls for somewhere in the mid, and then the last week you start ramping up again. But if you set your campaign up really well and do quite well from the beginning and start hitting 100%, once you're over it, people see it as like, wow, she's 110%, this must be really good because someone's already over their goal, so let's, I want to boost it too, I want to be part of this, right? People, like, that we've seen, once someone gets over their goal, they actually start rising pretty quick because it's just a confirmation piece for people as well, like, oh, all these other boosts, them must be good, I want to be part of this now. Yeah?
There's a ATV boost you're using crowdsourcing platforms to help bring in crowd towards funding.
So the website itself is essentially bringing in the crowd.
But you don't use any third party.
No, so what are, so what kind of third parties are you, for example, thinking
of? Through Kickstarter and Indiegogo, there's platforms that basically
Yeah, fair enough. So to that question, so basically Booster and Kickstarter are very much the same thing. Kickstarter, Indiegogo, those are crowdfunding.
Sure, I know, but they're partner websites that source the crowd, they attract, they basically advertise your...
Yeah, that's what we do too. So that's why, for example, we have the Booster States events to expose and promote your campaign. We have our social media handles, we have our newsletters,
okay.
we do a whole bunch of campaigning
so
around that. Yeah, we're putting effort into that crowd comes to the website and support the campaign. Yeah, absolutely. Question here?
So one of our online participants asked, my crowdfund is already live, but it's on GoFundMe. Does it matter, or do I have to move it to ATV Booster?
So that's a two-way question. So we highly discourage going on two platforms at the same time because of that part of you need to hit a certain goal. So GoFundMe is donation-based, right? So they're probably just donating, I'm assuming here. But
yeah.
If, let's say, you're trying to raise $10,000, and both on, let's for example, Kickstarter, you got $10,000, and a Booster, you got $10,000. What if at both, you end the campaigns at each equal as $5,000? That means you actually raised $10,000, but neither of them you hit the goal, so you don't, still don't get anything at all. So we've had entrepreneurs before that actually did a Booster first, just to get local exposure, test it out, learn from crowdfunding, and then by the time they were either successful or failed, they use that experience to move on to Kickstarter and use experience to do it again. So if this person wants to do a crowdfund campaign and they're still on GoFundMe, I would highly recommend taking that offline if possible.
Okay.
And then focus on this, maybe later do GoFundMe, but I'm curious what the business model is if the fact that they're on GoFundMe.
It's actually a service-based business.
Okay.
Yeah.
Could work, depends what it means, man.
Okay, I don't know.
Sure, yeah.
Are there limitations on the amount that can be raised through crowd? Like, I'm fairly familiar with it, so I know in Ontario, compared to Alberta, there's different rules.
Okay.
So what's the maximum per year?
There's no max you can do. The only minimum we've set is $5,000. No, if you think you can hit $1 million, go for it. Yeah, absolutely. There's no limit to that, to how far you can go. Yep.
Does the money have to be used to kind of run the business? Can you do a campaign on a good business idea and raise the money to go and validate that business idea? Is that, or does it have to be, okay, this is my business and whatever I raise is going to be enough to get it going?
So the way how I can't think kind of works is that, like, it's up to you what you do with the funds in the end, but the way how you're promoting your crowdfunding campaign, it kind of has to make sense for the crowd, right? If you're just saying, hey, I'm just doing crowdfunding to raise some money and see what I'll do with it, people are maybe not as inclined to boost your campaign because they don't really get it. Like the video, for example, we saw from Heather, which was very clearly explaining why she's doing the crowdfunding part. So as long as the, whatever reason you're doing crowdfunding, it has to sort of make sense with the crowd itself. But in the end, yeah. It's up to you what you do with the funds, essentially. As long as you don't, like I said earlier today, need other things, as long as you don't go to the Bahamas with it, it's okay. Yeah? Other questions? Yeah?
Two, actually.
Sure.
The one, the We Believe in You credit card.
Yeah?
That's a credit card, not like a preloaded credit card?
No, it's a credit card with a limit of
$10,000.
Of $10,000.
Yeah. And then that other, the
community partners, like the legal and accountant, are they local?
Yeah, they're
in which city you're in, or?
Yeah, to kind of spread out across Alberta, I'd say there are some companies on there that are Canada-wide. There's some larger law firms, for example, on there, some larger accountants, but we've tried to keep it very much local, like other startups actually on there to do videos, for example. They're probably the same stage as you guys, so I try to pick the ones that are kind of like startups as well.
So if we do one in Lethbridge, then the partners on there would be firms?
I'm working on it, to be honest.
Okay.
Yeah. It's just a long process before I can have someone on the website, but I'm working to get local partners on there now.
Cool. Okay. Yeah, I think I got a
shout-out
too.
No, I just didn't want to leave you hanging up here if there was some other questions or anything.
Cool. All right, well, thanks, everyone. I'm actually driving straight back to Calgary, but I do have two team members in the back, Kim and Shannon, right in the back waving. So if you've got any questions after, feel free to hit them up. Otherwise, I got postcards at the corner there where Heather's sitting actually right now. They're purple. Bring those. And then, thank you.
Thanks to Stefan and to Heather. So Heather, I think it's really exciting to have somebody local. I don't know about you, but I always relate to something better when I actually, physically touch somebody and go, okay, this is like a Lethbridge campaign, and this, you know, it's something that's possible. It's not necessarily something that's happening in the big city or in the United States or anything else. And I also love what you say when, you know, like a good point is if you have a 30-day campaign, you know, it's human nature to wait till like almost day 30 and then really push. So again, don't do that on your business plan. Get it done. And a big fear always is, right? I mean, we try to validate our business ideas. We go out, we go to friends and family, we go to people that we know, and we know that they tell us what we want to hear and what they think we want to hear. So a program like this, I mean, it really outsources the fact that a lot of these people don't know who you are, don't know anything about you. So if they're willing to put up some money on a crowd and support your business, you're going to have a really good feeling about it. I think it's just going to encourage you and validate that, you know, that it's a good moving forward part. So with that, I mean, I think it's really exciting too that ATB has agreed to have, so depending on, hopefully we'll have at least two people who want to try this crowdsourcing, and that you'll have an opportunity to even validate your business more, get on stage. And the publicity and the, just the awareness of your business will go tenfold. It's like just, like we talk to people who win the Chinook Challenge and just, most people go into it for the money, but it's the partners and it's the media and it's just all the other things that come along with it that make you successful. So good luck, think about it. We're going to take about a 10-minute break while we get set up for Tim, and it's a nice lead-in because Tim's business is, he's going to be talking, about the social media, about the marketing, the online marketing, and he's a whiz at this stuff, so we're totally, totally excited to have Tim with us tonight. So 10 minutes, and then we'll reconvene. Thanks.
Thank you.
Yeah.
We're gonna have to change the car.
Yeah, I'll run into the...
Yeah.
Pointed to and said, this is the fellow you need to do, and he does, he knows his business, he is really amazing. So he started his business in Lethbridge, All in One Digital in 2015, and since then he successfully operated and expanded business to Calgary, so we were just chatting, and so from the day I first met him, he was doing this on his own, now he's 7 employees, so that's really, really impressive in that short period of time. And so I think, you know, with our presentation earlier, I think Tim's going to give us a lot of advice, and he's got a lot of good knowledge. So I want to invite Tim up and say, teach us well.
I do suffer from chronic baby face syndrome.
It's a blessing in the long run.
So I'm going to talk about social media. It definitely plays a role in a larger umbrella of things that are going to be important for you in business. And I think ATV actually kind of did a lot of talking for me. So I think you're going to see a lot of kind of lined up points between the two. Hope you get some value out of it. Feel free to ask questions. I did leave a couple spots in here where I'm going to hopefully ask some of you guys to participate. So I hope you guys are okay with talking about your business. And without further ado, I'm going to start with a bit of a story. And this is something that happened last year on social media. And it was about a little Lethbridge restaurant. Right? I got to put this on this camera. This is weird for me. This little business suffered from the fact that nobody knew about them. And the business owner, who had been open for 7 years, hadn't paid himself in 3 months because he hadn't had any customers come in to restaurant. On August 21st, he had a customer come in and sit down with him. This is the first time that this customer had ever sat down with him. And the business owner, for whatever reason, started telling him about why he hadn't paid himself in 3 months. And this business owner's in his 70s, and this is his retirement strategy. It's a kind of heart-wrenching story. And so this customer posted it on social media. One photo and two paragraphs on social media on August 21st, and the next day it's shared by more than 7,700 people across North America and spreading at a faster rate every single day. On the 23rd, that restaurant is so overwhelmed with people visiting them, there's lines around the block. And the business owner said they've never seen that sort of business. In his 7 years, that day was better than his best month. He had multiple news platforms reaching out to him by the 24th, that he had multiple interviews, he had over 100 Google reviews, over 50 Facebook reviews. Everybody loved a little fish and chip shop on West Lethbridge that nobody knew about previously. And it comes down to the fact that nobody knew he was there. As sad of a story as that is, and as a bit of a plug that is of how important your real estate location is, something I'm going to talk about, it's the fact that there's such a power in social media that never existed before. And it is such an opportunity for you guys to talk about what you're about to do, entrepreneurship and your business. So yeah, with Beast Fish and Chips, one of my favorite little stories. I'm going to take a step back. So I'm going to talk a little bit, this is a little bit more on the umbrella, not just social media, but marketing as a whole. I've kind of tried to simplify down into the most basic element, and that is visibility and credibility. A2B says like trust and credibility, I think those are kind of one and the same thing. People need to know you exist before they even can shop with you. People need to trust that you're a good option and can service them well before they ever will shop with you. And so those, both of those things are super important. And they'll feed into each other. So gaining visibility with social media. There's three main branches of things you're gonna do on social media. And I'm gonna go back into more detail of all three of these in a little bit here. But posting is something you're gonna hear me talking a lot. Advertising, I'm gonna say a lot, and engaging, I'm gonna say a lot. So, don't worry, I'll come back to them if you're taking notes. Gaining credibility with social media. So gaining credibility, they work hand in hand, but it's super important to stay relevant with social media. With all things going on, stay relevant, show what you do, show the difference that you make, and get other people to talk about you as well. Show those reviews, get other people talking about your business. Don't just, you know, keep posting about how great you are. I might be going a little bit fast. I'm going too fast?
Yes.
Thank you for being honest. Visibility and credibility. They play super hand in hand. The biggest piece that discourages people right off the bat is that they launched yesterday and then, you know, today I'm not 7,700 shares. I'm not on global news. Whitby's is a beautiful example of all of these things communicating together and creating a crazy concoction. It takes a lot of time. Your visibility, you won't build credibility unless people see what you do. People won't see what you do unless you do it well and gain credibility. So they feed into each other. You are credible with some people right off the bat. And you can pay to get in front of people right off the bat. So you can use those kind of systems to start small and grow it into something. But don't worry if you're not going viral on the very first post. Posting on social media. Posting on social media is not nearly as difficult as it somehow is, but I won't complain because it gave me a job, so I'm pretty lucky on that. Posting, don't overthink it, is what I'm getting at. It's something that you do every single day. It's talking with people. It's nothing more than that. Same as you would, if you were to talk to somebody in front of you, what are you gonna say to them about your business? Okay, post that on social media. How can you make that same message go through social media? Where people get stuck on is, well, but like, should I do it on Facebook, should I do it on Instagram? Picking the right social media is also not hard. Start with what you know. What you know and what you use, probably what your customers are going to use, because the problem that you're going to solve is probably a problem that you have, which means people like you are going to have it, and so start there. It's not always perfect, but as a general rule of thumb, what you use and what you do is usually a good starting spot. Perfect and refine it over time. So if you have a business and you're not 100% sure what social media account you do, this is a template I use for the 7-second pitch. I'm not sure if this goes against something you were already taught, so I apologize if it does. This is what I teach people. So if you have a 7-second pitch, pitch it to me, and I will tell you what social media account you do. So introduce yourself. Again, if you have a different 7-second pitch, then that'll work. But mine is, hi, I'm Timothy with All In Digital. I help business owners by teaching them how to use internet to effectively market their business. It could be, hi, I'm Angel, and I help
serving the best food in Lethbridge.
Perfect. Angel, you should be on Instagram talking about how amazing your food is, and Facebook, because that's what I think moms are gonna be. Are moms your target audience? think Snapchat might also be cool for you, for hungry students.
I know, but I'm so old to learn. I just mastered Instagram.
Anybody else brave enough? 7 seconds?
I'm Heather, founder of Reflect, and I sell coffee for a cause.
That's such an amazing business idea. Facebook is going to be the biggest one. One, because it's a social cause, and virality. Social is the best platform to get other people to share. It's the easiest one, where my aunt is a chronic sharer, and she's going to love that. And so that's where you're going to have the biggest impact. Instagram, there's going to be a lot of people that really appreciate your brand. And LinkedIn, I'm sorry, I wouldn't be huge on LinkedIn, because I think the lovers of are the people you're going to give goosebumps with your video, not the people that are doing it. I think people that are doing it are a little bit more selfless, and they don't necessarily, they're like their husband and aren't going to want the attention.
Yes. Thank you.
7 seconds? Going once?
Hi, I'm Maggie, and I help people earn rebates by shopping locally.
Perfect. Budget buyer. Twitter is going to be a big one. For every time you get a new coupon, Twitter is checked often, and it's very news blasty. It's very, very relevant. What's going on right now? Every time you get a new coupon that you can offer somebody, post it on Twitter. That'll be a good one for you. Advertising on Twitter, they are really, really aggressive with what they're trying to do. Another good one. Snapchat will be big for you. Students are always trying to save money. So Snapchat, that'll be a big one. Facebook a little bit, because they do offers. And you can have a time that kind of ticks down. I think those would be good. Any like really oddball businesses that aren't going to be the big three social media businesses?
Hi, I'm Amanda, your muscle mechanic. I help optimize your muscular system by focusing on your weak links and reducing compensation.
Mm-hmm. I like that one a lot. Instagram is going to be big for you, because it's a big platform, but Quora, look into it, Q-O-U-R-A. Now that's kind of like Yahoo Answers, and what it is people write in, ask questions, and get answers. And people ask the internet for everything that they're ashamed to ask people in person, so they're going to ask you on Quora, and you're going to answer, and it is amazing how many answers, just you can spend probably an hour a night on there answering people's questions of, hey, how come I can't get rid of like this little piece right here? Hey, you're gonna wanna get a more defined chest, stuff like that. If you just answer all day long, it'll play huge for boosting your social media as well as a website in the future. Or is great for building a search engine optimization, but that's a conversation for a whole nother day. Last one. YouTube is going to be big. The gaming YouTube community is ginormous. Get on that comment section and start talking about the games that you commonly see with your customers. Start getting into those YouTube comments, because there's a couple massive YouTubers that are going to dominate that sphere. Secondly, Snapchat maybe a little bit, but not too much. Reddit might also be another big one. It's R-E-D-D-I-T, Reddit, R-E-D-D-I-T. It's similar to Quora, but a little bit more form-based, and you join communities that are really big on topics. And so you're going to find lots of little gaming communities, and you're going to find communities on specific games as well. And you're going to find lots of customers out there. All right. So what should you post on all of these things I just talked about? You're going to get your two biggest ideas for what you do, what's going on around you. It's as simple as that. Show your work is super important. I love that the ATB example that they did. I dislike the fact that he only talked about that. Look at the branding and the stuff that's around her business that she talks about. It's super important, but it's super important to balance out both of the fact. She had a lot of posts that were, hey, look what I do, it's really, really cool. She had some cool quotes, but she also had pictures of the eyelashes that she had done. That's a huge piece of what people do. Yeah, it's super awesome that Michael Jordan wears Nike shoes. It's really cool that they have a cool slogan and a cool swoosh and they post quotes, but the shoes are still cool. They sell nicely designed shoes. Your product, your service, it still needs to be good, and people aren't gonna give you that shot right off the bat unless your product is really, really strong. So show off what you do, show off the difference you make. I know this is harder for service people. If your business is a service-based business like mine, show off the effect of what's going to happen. Do rake leaves before and after. If you help businesses, show, hey, this is what their sales were yesterday, this is what their sales are today. If you are coaching people, testimonials, video testimonials, huge. And that video is huge in general. Stay relevant. Staying relevant has as much to do with what's popular right now. This is a quote, I'm not even sure who told me this. Somebody said, how you do something is how people assume you do everything. If you have a crummy looking social media post, people are gonna assume that you don't care that much, is what it's gonna come across as. It might come across to you as, oh, I'm not a graphic designer, I'm not very good at this stuff. You will get everything you need to get good at social media in one of these, I promise. There's YouTube videos, graphic design is not hard, don't need Photoshop. There are apps you can download, just search graphic design or cool posts or nice looking stuff on Google, and it'll pop up on this, I promise. This is magic if you haven't found out yet. This is magic. Girls, stay relevant. This is the side that is branding. This is the side that, okay, this, my business is at, what I do, the difference I make is at the center of what I do, but everything relevant around it is where I'm gonna get my customers. Your first customer, your initial customer is gonna be the person just like you, that product or service gives me goosebumps and fills the exact need I needed. But as you grow and you get on more customers, you're gonna get people that are, I also like good coffee. I don't know, I'm gonna buy coffee anyway, might as well get one that also supports a brand. The people that don't have 100% of the same passions that you do, but 60% can still be a customer. So play in that, what's relevant. Baby blends, RCMP is relevant. Coffee, beer is relevant. play in that sphere, play with what's important to you and play in the space around it as well. But keep it all together, keep it all relevant. What not to post on social media. Number one is the same thing on each network. First thing that people do when they say, oh, I gotta do social media marketing. I see you smiling, you're doing this right now, aren't you? You're posting the same thing on Animal. Shame, for shame.
What do you mean by that? I'm sure it was you or somebody else said to do it over and over again.
Let's say
if you have an event coming up, or you have...
I should word this a little better. Don't post the same, you can post the same thing again on Instagram. Like if you have a, hey, I'm doing an event on Facebook. Yeah, post it again on Facebook. Don't use the same post on Facebook as you would Instagram, as you would Reddit, as you would Quora.
What?
You know why? Because two paragraphs and a photo work great for Facebook. Nobody's reading two paragraphs on Instagram. You can't even write two paragraphs on Twitter. It doesn't work. I promise. You have to become a native to the platform. Use Instagram and you'll get used to Instagram. Instagram is all about just like, oh, look at, in this specific moment, I'm doing what you should do. That's what Instagram's about. It's artistic, it's feeling, it's filters, and it's Instagram models is what it's about. So it's like, that is a completely different theme that's gonna hit and reach somebody completely different than the people that love Facebook. People that love Facebook, 35 to 65 year old females, my aunt, my mom, they share stuff back and forth, they're on all the time, I get 50 tags a day, I got rid of it off my phone. There's a lot going on Facebook, and it's not to do with me, because it's just not me. So it's super important to figure out, okay, what are people expecting? And this ties back into stay relevant. When I'm scrolling through my Facebook feed, I see a post that looks really bad. When we get to the ads, I have a really good example of someone that's not staying relevant and something that just looks bad, looks out of place. There's good sticking out and you know being different, but there's a bad sticking out being different as well. And we all have a pretty good intuitive sense of what that is. But if you're not paying attention to what normal is, you won't, and it'll be you. So, number two, the same thing over and over again. This isn't necessarily pertaining to events. This is month after month, a lot of my clients, I sit down with them every single month. What are we going to talk about this month? What's super important this month? Oh, I don't know. Let's just do the same thing we did last month. There's only so many ways I can talk about brushing your teeth before people lose interest. A dentist client, I shouldn't specify. That's kind of a weird thing to talk about otherwise. You got to shake things up a little bit. And that's where you play in that sphere of relevancy. Do things. People want new news. People don't want the same old, same old. How is your bravery blend going to be used by someone new? I'm standing in the way of my slides here. How can it be used in a new light? Who's using it this week that wasn't using it last week? How are we going to launch a new product this week that we didn't launch last week? What's new on the menu? Where are we distributing this week? That sort of, hey, this is something that's new and relevant, what's going on with me right now, is super important in social media. Think of this example. In an offline sense, if you were going to have a conversation with somebody and they said, what's new? That's a pretty common way to start a conversation, isn't it? What's new with you? What if somebody said the exact same thing to you every single time for the last year and a half? You'd probably stop asking them what's new because you already know the response. That's going to happen with social media. If you say the same thing over and over and over again, people are going to stop following you because they already know what you're supposed to know. They know about you, at least, I guess. That's good. Good job. But they're not going to stay updated. And social media is all about building people that are just hanging on every single word that you say. 3, giveaways. Giveaways are the bane of me as a social media marketer because they're so lazy. Come on. You be a little more creative. Giveaways, unfortunately, work in what I call vanity metrics. Giveaways get people interested because who doesn't like free crap? Everybody likes free crap, especially if you're giving away a gift card, $20 to Tim Hortons. Okay, I shop at Tim Hortons. What's $20? You want me to like your thing? All right, here's a like. Nobody likes what you're doing. They like Tim Hortons. Nobody likes what you're doing. They like free money. If you're going to do a giveaway, do it right. Give away coffee if you're doing coffee. Give away a tour of the facility. It's an awesome product. It's an awesome thing. Everybody knows it. Buy it, guys. Come on. It's coffee. Who doesn't drink coffee? And me, to be honest. I drink tea, though. Tea is good. I mean, okay, I drink tea. Make it relevant to your business. Talk about what's going on with you. Giveaways are slippery slope to talking about something that's completely relevant to you. And instead talking about what, you know, people like, which is free stuff. So posting to social media. Stay relevant, use what you want to be posting. If you're gonna be using Instagram for your business, use it for your personal life. Follow your competitors, follow other people that are using. Follow every single social media out there. You can click on the trending or the top profiles. Follow what they're doing because those are the people that are using the platform the most, and they're going to give you that baseline of this is what normal looks like. 2, follow others. Think of the audience before you post. That's it. That is number one conversationalism of just being a good social person, is what does this other person want me to talk about? Talk about what interests me. Ask people questions. People will like you if you like them. That's just how humans work. It works the same on social media. Just ask people, talk about them, figure out what's important to them, and you're gonna be just miles ahead with social media. The second platform, I'm gonna take a sip of water because I'm shouting at you guys like preachers. Advertising on social media. All right. So, social media is creepy as hell. One time I had a meeting with somebody. He didn't tell me where his house was. I didn't know it was at his house until after I scheduled the meeting. Don't ask too many questions. I Googled him, found out where he worked. His cell phone number was listed. Found his cell phone number, Googled it, found he had a social media post where he listed his cell phone number. And he had his address listed on Facebook. So I showed up at his house and was like, here for that meeting. Oh, I forgot to send you my address. Yeah, we're past that button. Come on. Super weird, but Facebook has a ton of data on you. And when you're advertising, Facebook, Instagram are the biggest ones that you can utilize that to the ninth degree. Touched on this actually, I'm getting a little bit ahead of myself, but timing is super important when you're advertising. Timing is the biggest factor that's gonna play into whether an ad works or whether it doesn't. You could have the best campaign in the world, and if you did it on July weekend when nobody's looking at it and everybody's camping, it doesn't matter how good it is. Advertising. So right now, the big thing that you're going to want to perfect is asking people to do something. Advertising is not the point where you're going to be like, hey, watch our cool video. Hey, like our page for more updates. No, go buy coffee, buy this, support this, come and do this. You want to be very direct with what I want you to do, because that's what's going to get people to actually do things. It's very, very easy to fall into a thing of just like, oh, cool, like what's people kind of autopilot scroll through Facebook and social media. It's really easy to just kind of like, oh, that's kind of a cool video, like keep scrolling. You have to be very, very direct to kind of snap people out of it. It doesn't work great all the time for posting outside of things. When you're posting, you kind of want to play and blend in and get those likes, get those shares. But when you're advertising, this is when you're looking for results. This is when you want to break people out of that chain. This is what I want you to do. Come through this doorway to my website, to my funding page, whatever it is, but make sure you ask. And that should be the big and bold is, this is what I want you to do. Reviews. It helps so much to get other people to talk about you. It's how many businesses say the best service in town, the best bagel in town. I don't know why that popped in my head, but whatever reason. We're so off. It just gets drowned out. It's just the same thing over and over again. No, everybody thinks that they're the best at that, and consumers are just inundated with the point that they're kind of bored of it. It is a slippery slope. It's pretty easy to tell. Anyone shop on Amazon? Hopefully all of you, if you're alive. Amazon is huge. There's tons of reviews on there, and they're the worst for, it's very common for people to buy Amazon reviews. But I scroll through them. Like people do read through them, and you can tell the difference between, wow, awesome, perfect product, and hey, this is the best product ever. I used it for this. I couldn't find a better solution anywhere else. I went through five of these things before I finally ended up on this one. That's the review that you want. And when you find people that are really, really passionate about it, Colin Ross with Whippy's Fish and Chip, that's a perfect example. He wrote two paragraphs. He went out of his way to go do something for your business, and it shows. People have a great BS meter, and that is, it always shows. You're right. The superficial, hey, we got a 5-star review, people are gonna kind of see through that. Even if they don't know that, you know, they had a marketing company paying people to write those, they're gonna see through it. But, yeah.
What do you think about asking people for a review?
Oh, 100%, yeah.
Because I've done that with past people that I've worked for. I may not get everybody I've asked, but I do get some.
To be honest, that's usually what it takes. Like there is a ton of people that would give me a review, give me a testimonial, and without asking for it, people don't know what you need until you ask for it. And so asking for it is 100% what you need to do. Bribing somebody for it, that's, you know, let the politicians figure that out. That's a gray area.
That's a good way to ask for a review.
Did you like, have you liked my presentation so far?
Yeah.
Would you give me a review?
It was a Facebook page, and you base your reviews on that. How do you ask somebody? Like, someone said you're fishing, you're not supposed to be in that awkward spot.
Awkward, unless you make it feel awkward. It's don't overthink it. It's pretty normal. With social media, okay, we're going to take another sidestep here. Why social media has just blown up is people are socially awkward as heck nowadays. Social media gives them the ability to like kind of just like block out that like elephant in the room that they don't really want to talk about and just like walk away. Social media just lets me scroll past that. If that comes across awkward, nobody's paying attention to it. The big, maybe don't like take out a big ad and like, you know, get a big flashy like 5 stars today sort of a thing. But if you just ask, hey, like our stuff, don't forget to leave me a review. If people like your stuff, that's gonna stick out to them and they're gonna give you a review. If it doesn't, if they're not crazy about you, they're just gonna scroll past it. Nobody's hanging on literally every word that you say, but yeah. So don't overthink it, I guess is what I'd say. I think I'm like way, now my slides are all messed up, so. posting versus advertising. So this is a really fine line. And you probably can't read the text on these two social media posts. On the left, we got just got the best produce on the market. And on the right, it's fig season again. Come visit Jasper's Market. Hey, this is what I'm up to today. Hey, got a great score today. This is awesome. Versus, this is what you need to come and do. It's virtually the same thing, but on two different sides for two different purposes. If all of your posts are, hey, come and see me, come and do this, come and do that, you're gonna turn people off. Nobody likes the, I have a couple friends that like get into, you know, selling those like multi-level marketing things, and it's, every time they text me, it's like, oh, I'm not gonna even respond to you because I know that you're gonna get me to come and see your stupid thing again. So you don't wanna sell all the time. It's super important. This is what I'm up to. This is what I'm up to. This is what I'm up to. When you start getting people asking, like, that's pretty cool. How can I get involved? All right, this is how you get involved. The advertising side, which should be, you know, maybe 20% of what you're doing online, that's when you're gonna be, if this is you, go and do that. If this is you, go and do that. Ad costs, so this is a 2017 average of all of our clients. And something that I probably shouldn't publish because, you know, I have an upmark on that. And a nice suit because of it. So that is what it's gonna cost you from Facebook. That number right there is $8.50 for to get your picture, your post, your advertisement in front of 1,000 people on Facebook. And that's average of a bunch of different industries, a bunch of different clients for big campaigns, small campaigns, across a whole bunch of them. The reason I use impressions in this, an impression is every single time your ad goes in front of somebody, potentially in front of somebody. You're gonna commonly see reach as well on social media. The reason I use impressions here is because newspapers, radio, pretty much every advertiser is gonna talk to you in impressions, and they're gonna be like, I'm gonna get you in front of 80,000 people a day, and it's all fake, nothing is real, don't worry about it. Reach with social media is huge, because Facebook can track me. I use the same Facebook account on my computer, on my phone, on my tablet, not on my phone, I got rid of my phone, but you know what I mean. If I did use Facebook on my phone, it would be with their app, and they can track Tim everywhere he goes. And so they can see reach, how many people. To get in front of 1,000 people reach-wise, it costs about $50 versus $8.50 impressions. So that gives you a good kind of metric that you can even match up with other platforms as well when they're saying, this is how many impressions you're gonna see. Well, all right, how many of those are the same people over and over again? How many people are actually awake when they're looking at that? I'm gonna get too far into that. Hey, people are gonna get mad at me. But it is super affordable. $100 is not very many ads in other platforms. Adds a lot in social media. So, very affordable platform. The perfect advert. I have a link here, so hopefully you're gonna get this presentation as well. That link is to the 30 elements of value, and it's something that was published by the Harvard Business Review, and it is a gold mine of information, something that you have to look at. It's a pyramid structure, and it's based off of Maslow's hierarchy of needs, which, you're not 100% familiar with it, it's basically people have fundamental needs at the bottom. People need to be safe, people need to be fed. At the top, they have like very intellectual needs. People want to, you know, contribute. People want to be part of a community, etc. That is, it's broken down into 30 different pieces, and you can kind of go through with like a checklist of why is what I'm doing valuable to my customers. Yeah, a restaurant sometimes get customers because I'm going to starve to death if I don't find the closest restaurant right now. But most people in North America aren't about to starve to death, so you're probably gonna, there are other factors are gonna play into which restaurant they pick. Maybe the people that they run into, maybe the where the food is sourced from, whether they feel like they're giving back. Ruby Blends, again, a perfect example of how many people bought it just because it was coffee. Well, if it's just coffee, yeah, maybe I can go to the grocery store. But the brand of coffee at the grocery store isn't going to give back to my husband, who is not my husband, not this fictional character.
That's how rumors start. That's all I'm saying.
That's why I just nipped that one right there.
It'd be okay if.
There's emotion. People are emotional creatures. All right. There's many movies out there, and most of them, you know, the storyline is not that interesting. It's a journey. It's ups and downs. People like to be emotional, and so you have a ton of value in your business that you're not even realizing. Doesn't fit on a spreadsheet. Look at 3 elements of value and work your way up. Why are people buying your product? This is what I was talking about sticking out for all the wrong reasons. This I'm 99% certain that this is an advertisement somebody that did in the Herald, and then they were like, well, this is basically social media stuff too. Let's just cut this out, put it on social media. This doesn't work. Everybody hates this. Don't do this. They've got so much text in the picture that is terrible. And a really important thing to notice when you're using social media, unlike this offline, you know, me communicating with you, Facebook is a business. Twitter is a business. YouTube is a business. And their business is in keeping people's attention. And so you doing this hurts their goal of keeping people's attention, which means they're going to bill you triple to do it, or they're not going to let you do it. So in the Facebook, if you're doing a Facebook advertisement, they won't let you put more than 20% text inside a photo. The photo is meant to be for photo. There's a text box for your text. You know, don't apples and oranges, like don't mix those things. So they're very, very strict on those rules. And Carcom, you guys are gonna do what they're gonna do, but if they're gonna advertise this, this is a classic example of to get those 1,000 impressions. I've seen that number go as high as $70 for 1,000 impressions. Because somebody was too lazy to be a little bit creative, and you know, how can we show off a car in a, like, what the heck is it? Like, who buys a car because you can't even see the car behind all that text? Show off just the product, there's a text box, be clear of what you want people to do, and they'll buy it. Don't, every ad does not need to be everything for every person, okay? Yeah, slow down, maybe take a break again, do some jumping jacks or something.
Tiffy, you should go help that auto company.
I don't want to talk about it. engage. This is probably the most important piece of social media. Hello. Probably the shortest piece in here because it's so incredibly hard to teach people how to do it. In the way of it's going to come naturally or it's kind of not going to. It is the fact that a lot of people grow up being very, very comfortable communicating themselves over the internet. I realize I kind of jumped ahead of my slides, so I'm going to leave that with you. I'm going to come back to it in a second. So engaging with people, it's all about the community, getting other people to talk about you and talking to them. Spark conversations around your work. Show the process, what goes into your work, what's gonna make you different, what's making you stand out. Use that, those differentiating factors, to start conversations with people. and then keep that conversation going. People are genuinely interested in business. One of my favorite examples of this is actually a paint company. This paint company doesn't advertise, look at like this awesome house with like our shade of purple in it. They show paint mixing videos where they blend the paint tones together. And it is a really seemingly boring thing, and it's a normal part of their everyday life, but people love watching that on the internet. It's, you know, kind of hypnotic, it's relatively interesting. It's something that normal people don't see on an everyday basis, and so it's interesting. Show off that weird angle of your business and then what goes into producing it, and people, I promise people love that. All right, back to that thing I told you to put a pin. People are very, very comfortable communicating online now in a way that they weren't before. If you are often the person that sends an email and people are like, why are you so angry? And you're like, I'm not angry, I just like sent an email or a text message. Vice versa, if people send you a message and you're like, why is this person angry at me? Social might, it might be an uphill battle for you, but it is super worthwhile. And it comes down to the fact that this is how people communicate nowadays, and the only way to really learn it is to kind of just immerse yourself in it and see how people talk and listen to its tone, it's a whole bunch of things that if I had a PhD, I might be able to tell you what they are, but I don't, and it's very organic, okay? It's people talking. Daniel Pink's book, To Sell as Human, kind of touches on this topic. And it's all about just kind of removing that barrier between you talking with people as a business. To sell is human, whether you're selling an idea, whether you're selling yourself asking somebody out, whether you're selling your, weird way to say that, but don't sell yourself, people. It's whether you're selling an idea, whether you're selling a product, whether you're selling your, you know, a bedtime, whether you're selling, you know, broccoli to a toddler, whatever it is, your communication is, hey, this is something I think you should do, this is something I think you need to know. That's what it is, and it's a very human thing. And as soon as people introduce this business element, people are worried about exactly what you said, where, well, I don't want to be pushy, like, how do I ask for this? And it's like, the way you'd ask for it if you were a human, which hopefully you are, it is a normal thing. It's just a mental block of, you know, oh, well, I don't want to be this, and I don't want to be that, and I don't want to do that. Just be you, and it works. Some tips I've found that maybe help is let others talk. People like to talk about themselves. Ask questions. Ask, hey, you like this? Why did you like it? You bought my product? Why did you buy my product? Why is this important to you? How can this video give you goosebumps? That, right there. How come this gave you goosebumps? It would be a perfect conversation for somebody to open up, especially in the case of Burberry Blends, of, well, this person I know suffers from PTSD. That elevates the, you know, going back to that Maslow's hierarchy of needs, that takes the conversation from a level of, oh, you know, how's your day? Oh, I'm good. It takes it to a, this is what I care most about, and creates a, that's what's going to create super, super loyal customers. And more than customers, it's gonna create people you enjoy spending your time around. Bottom one is become an expert in what you're talking about. That's a pretty simple thing, you know, to say. It's a pretty hard thing to do, but it'll give you such an advantage. If you know everything about what you do, you're not gonna run out of things to say. It's as simple as that. When you're posting, when you're talking to people about something, if your knowledge only goes to this, well, I buy it from here and I sell it to you. That isn't gonna go all that far. Where entrepreneurs are succeeding and becoming huge is the fact that it started as a personal passion for them to do something that was super important to them. And so they spend, it's almost an obsession about, I needed to know everything about this, and then sharing it. That's how you become an expert, and that's how you're gonna get people to just really, really care about what you're doing. Great way to do this is in the comment section. This social media has evolved out of people's need to communicate faster, more efficiently, at scale, and this is where they do it. So much, especially of business, they're gonna see their, oh, like, how's my page doing? Or they're gonna scroll through, oh yeah, that picture looks pretty, and I posted that one and it looks pretty, oh, I got 57 likes on this one. Because social media is about social media. It's about people talking about what they're seeing and about seeing what other people are talking about. Use that to your advantage. Talk to people through social media. And every single platform has this comment section for a reason, and it's for you to leave comments and for people to leave comments to you. You want to encourage it, you want to use it, and you want to talk. And then just do all those things, and then good job. You've done a lot of good things with social media. Congratulations. It's hard. It's a process. It's going to take patience. It's going to take practice. Use your magic device, what's called a cell phone. It connects to the internet if you haven't heard of it. It's huge. It's amazing. Google is God. No, that's a bit of a gray area to go into. But, Google knows all, and use it. If you don't know how to do something, how do I do this? It works surprisingly well. And there's nothing that you can't learn through a YouTube video. And especially on the social media front, there's an app for it. So leverage it. But through that process, you're gonna get yourself out there, and you're gonna develop some credibility, and you're gonna develop some visibility. And now it's super important to do something with both of those things, because neither one of those things are a business in and of itself. So Heather said this perfectly. Use that to develop new connections and to develop customers. Yeah, customers is kind of what everyone kind of thinks is like the end goal through social media. Oh, I put in 20 posts and I get out 3.2 customers. Yeah, that, you know, as time goes on, you will see those metrics. You will see that trend of, you know, I do X amount of posts and this is what comes out of it. But the connections are so much more important, because it's what's going to answer to me. Okay. The connections are what's going to just kind of take your business to the next level. It's finding that distributor that is going to sell you your coffee for half the price you're currently buying it. It's that person that has a social media account of 50,000 people that has a significant other, has an important person in their life that is affected by PTSD. Those kind of connections and relationships start by putting yourself out there. Social media is a great platform for things to just kind of happen. Great example of this from a local business is, of course I can't remember the name, Charmed Playhouses. If you've heard of them, they build like ridiculous playhouses for kids. Like, these things are like castles and like crazy. They tweeted at a TLC executive, the TV channel TLC, and that tweet got them a television show across the world where they built, you know, Stephen Curry's playhouse for his kids. He's an NBA all-star. Like, that happens with social media. That has never existed before for any business ever. That is, entrepreneurship now is crazy compared to what it was. Not that I would actually know, but, you know. I recognize that I'm a very privileged individual growing up with the tools that we have now. It's crazy what you can do. But put yourself out there, follow the rules, and look for connections. Look for people that are interested in what you're doing, and how can I be interested in what you're doing? That's how those connections are going to start. Great way to test and prove. HB kind of touched on that part. That's really it. That's social media. ClickFunnels works. It works. It is what I do a lot for my clients in the way of, hey, this, how can I phrase this in the best possible way? I use it with business owners that are very, how many posts to get a sale? And that is an incredibly side of that is an incredibly important side of business. Keeping track of what's working, what isn't working is super important. But people don't necessarily fit into that rubric. And social media is social. Social media is people. And so it works, use it, don't forget about the people. Use the people on the top end, what's feeding your click funnel, and you're gonna be all right. If you reduce business, sales, client, customer communication to how many conversations do I have to have a sale? A common one with salespeople, how many cold calls, how many like random phone numbers do I have to dial, pick up, and like, hey, do you wanna buy this? No, okay. How many phone calls do I have to make before you buy something? If you focus solely on that number, it's gonna keep dropping, and you have to make 5 calls, and then 10 calls, and then 20 calls. Social media posts are gonna go 1 post, 2 posts, 10 posts, to 100 posts, and I'll always approach infinity of nobody's listening, because you don't care about me, I don't care about you. You care about me, I'll care about you. Oh, yeah, I guess I should say that. ClickFunnel. $88,000 active Facebook accounts in Lethbridge within a 10-mile radius. Okay. 88,000. Who here has 88,000 customers? Good. So we've started the funnel. This is how many customers you have out of your 88 potential customers. 88,000. All of these people eat food, I'm assuming. So 88,000 of them could go to your restaurant, but you know, how many of them are actually gonna drive to my restaurant if you know most of them are way out of the way? All right, so my area is, you know, I'm making these numbers up now, let's say 1,000 people. 1,000 people are around, let's say a 2-mile radius from my restaurant at lunchtime, okay? Out of that, you know what, 500 of them are pretty cheap. Making these numbers up, I'm a pretty upscale restaurant, so you know, 500 of them are, you know, above an income level of this amount. So I'm gonna hit all 500 of these people with my lunchtime ad. Of that, how many of them are gonna click on that ad and go to my book now restaurant deal? Okay, well, a click-through rate of 1% is, to be honest, pretty normal on social media. So you have 5 people out of that click on that ad and, oh, okay, yeah, perfect, where is this? Click, get directions, awesome. Out of that, you know, maybe some of them do it, maybe they don't. All right, so let's say 20% of them clicked on it saying, I want to go there for lunch. One of them decides, and I don't want to. This process is an offline click funnel of a funnel of, this is how many people I could have reached, this is how many people I ended up reaching. Click funnels is more on the website front of, okay, people start here, how many of them made it to this page on my website, how many people looked at a product, how many people added it to the cart, and how many people purchased it. But in all of them, okay, how many are reaching? Kind of narrow people down, qualify them as they make it down the funnel. So this is a perfect example of something I see often, where people sometimes get too specific and, you know, oh, I only want to reach, you know, high-end people in a 2-mile radius. All right, well, how much work are you going to put into this to get 5 customers? That's, again, why planning this out is super important from the business side and business owner perspective of figuring out, okay, how much time, energy, and effort should I put in to get how many customers? A good way to increase this would be, all right, maybe I do a deal. So I do a lunchtime deal, so now I can hit the 1,000 people, not just the 500. Now I've got, 10 people, and that just turned into 8 customers. Get 8 customers, I can make some ends meet off that. All right, this is worth doing a campaign. So a bit of an example. Might have gone too into detail there. Any other questions? I don't know what I'm at for time. Am I way over? Perfect?
Nice.
One social media to use, which would you choose?
Face to face is what I use. for me personally, this might shock a lot of you. I, when I started my business, did zero social media because I was teaching people how to use social media.
Number two then.
sorry. Number two?
Yeah.
Well, if you're asking for number two, you got time to do two social media. It comes down to you do more than one. Don't put all your eggs in one basket. Do them all. Facebook is the biggest, but if your customer is not my aunt, then it's not going to work for you. So it depends on who you are. Depends on who your customer is. If you're going for people like me, I like Instagram.
Just off the top of your head, because I think you know this, how many Facebook accounts are there in our area?
88,000. Last time I talked to you was 84,000. So.
Okay, and Instagram?
Question. That is not actually recorded.
Not exact. Okay, what about the other one? You said Snapchat.
Snapchat. It's not public.
It's not public. Damn. Because I think, like, you know, it's demographics, right?
Snapchat is a bit of a tricky one because it's hard. Snapchat is a very kind of communication based one. It's very me sending a snap to you, but where you're, how you could use it is going to be in the fencing. So you can set up, oh, I gotta go into how this works. Okay. So Snapchat, you're sending pictures to people and you apply these filters to pictures. Now, these filters are anything from, you know, silly cat ears to things that make you look a little more attractive, I mean, a lot of it, to things that, you know, add, this is the city I'm in, to things that, hey, I'm at Mocha Cabanas. And that's how you can use it, is more so people that are there.
Take themselves.
It's a trend, it can be a trendy thing. So you mark off your location of, hey, I'm here, and people can share with other people that, this is where I'm at. Hey, you just saw that post about my awesome lunch? Well, the post right after is, this is where I am. Or, same thing. And it's relatively affordable to do that. Inside the Snapchat app, you can make that filter.
Okay.
So it's pretty easy.
Facebook's still 88,000, that's a good chunk of our population.
That's an enormous, I hope you guys appreciate how many people that is. Like, that's a lot of people.
Like, aren't we just gonna hit 100 this year or something?
Yeah, well, it is in a radius. So, like,
yeah.
Coaldale fits in that radius.
Yeah.
Colehurst fits in that radius. Other things that I don't know fit in that radius.
No, you can always go to the city of Upper website and you can look up demographics.
Which you should do, and which somebody hopefully has told you how to do marketing, or will tell you how to do marketing.
Marketing research.
Important. As well. Any other questions on social media? Ask. But ask them to leave comments. Ask them a question. Hey, which one should we do? Should we produce a tea or a beer next? How many people do you think are going to comment on that? A lot of people are going to comment on that because people are passionate about beer. Any other questions?
I just want to